Time descends like a dove and baptized with fire. He comforts, guides, and corrects. He is the spirit of life, the essence of truth, the voice of God. And when you are alone, lost, and afraid, He will carry you home.
Called The Ghost. And you say, why is it called that? Well, basically, we're trying to understand the Holy Spirit as a person. And oftentimes when we think about the Spirit, we think about this impersonal force, we think about a ghost or some supernatural, mystical being that we can't quite connect with. And today, in the last few weeks, we're trying to say, no, the Holy Spirit's a person. He comforts us, He counsels us, He convicts us, He teaches us. We need to get to know who He is a little bit more. So turn in your Bibles to Acts chapter 2. We're going to go verse 22 today, and I want to just set the stage for you if I could. The 120 have been in the upper room. They've been praying for a number of days for the power of the Holy Spirit to fall upon them. Acts 2:1, the Holy Spirit comes in power. We hear about the sound of a rushing wind. We hear about tongues, seem to be tongues of fire. There's an imagery of being poured out. All these images of the Spirit, wind, fire, water, oil. And then the 120 come out of the upper room, and they come out into the streets around them, out into the community, and they began, the Bible says, declaring the wonders of God, each in their own tongue. So they're speaking foreign languages, and they're ministering to people. And what's unique about that is that when the Holy Spirit comes and empowers us, what is the first thing people do? The first thing that happens, Peter does not come out right away, start waving his hanky over the crowd, seeing people miraculously healed. That doesn't happen right away. The first thing that happens is not John walking around trying to cast demons out of people and that kind of thing. That's not the first thing that happens. Thomas is not off in a corner, you know, praying in a private prayer language or whatever it may be. That's not the first thing that happens. The first thing that happens is the 120, empowered by the Spirit, proclaim the Word of God. They proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I, if you know me and you know my background, I absolutely believe 100% in the miraculous power of the Holy Spirit, that He empowers us with supernatural gifts and everything else. But the first thing God does when He empowers the 120, they proclaim the Word of God. And I just want to say to you before we get started here, when you're filled with the Spirit and empowered, you will just, it will just overflow out of you. Proclaim the wonders of God and of Jesus Christ and the gospel. That will just come out of you. I get very nervous when I see people that are supposedly filled with the Spirit, but I don't ever see the proclamation of the gospel and the Word of God, okay? So that's what happens in this passage. Now, I don't know if you've heard this quote, but there's a quote out there that goes something like this. Light yourself on fire with passion, and people will come from miles to watch you burn. Anybody ever heard that quote at all? Okay, all eight of you. I love this quote. Because the idea is when someone is passionate about the things of God, it will attract people. And what we have in this scene is we have 120 on fire with passion, and crowds are starting to flock. Not just 20 or 30 people. 50 people, 100 people, not just 300 or 400 people. Thousands of people are flocking. In fact, I would guess that about 5 to 10,000 people are flocking around the 120, trying to figure out what's happening. And Peter steps forward with no amplification, no microphone or PA system, no big screen on the side, and to 5 or 10,000 people, he begins to proclaim the first message we have recorded in the book of Acts after Pentecost. And so I've asked someone who has a great voice to come and just proclaim this sermon. So Carrie, if you would, come on down. Remember now, Peter is speaking to thousands and thousands of people, and tell us exactly what he said.
Men of Israel, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. This man was handed over to you by God's set purpose and foreknowledge. And you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. David said about him, "I saw the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body also will live in hope. Because you will not abandon me to the grave, nor will you let your Holy One see decay." Here to this day, but he was a prophet and knew that God had promised him on oath that he would place one of his descendants on his throne. Seeing what was ahead, he spoke of the resurrection of Christ, that he was not abandoned to the grave, nor did his body see decay. And God has raised this Jesus to life, and we all are witnesses of that fact. Exalted to the right hand of God, he has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit and has poured out what you now see and hear. For David did not ascend to heaven, and yet he said, "The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet." Therefore, let all Israel be assured of this, that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ.
Whoa. 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 Yeah. And that was just the Cliff Notes version. Because Luke, no doubt, didn't transcribe the entire thing. He just said, here are the bits and pieces under inspiration of the Holy Spirit that I need to tell all of you. But Peter was on fire. I mean, he was absolutely filled with the Spirit and proclaiming this. We don't know how long. I mean, it could have been 2 hours. It could have been 30 minutes. Maybe it was as short as that. And all we know is that when he got done saying it, miraculous things happen. Next Sunday, you're going to hear more about that. But I want to show you a few things about Peter's sermon. And I said this before, if you're empowered with the Spirit, there's four things that accompany it. Number one, you will have conviction. Do you see a little conviction maybe in Peter as he was sharing? Second thing is you'll have courage. Courage to proclaim things to people that maybe before you were scared to talk to about the Lord, about Jesus, about your faith. I see some boldness in Peter. This Jesus whom you crucified, I don't care. I saw him crucified, but I'm just going to say it all out because I'm empowered with the Spirit. And there's thousands of you, but I might as well be bold. I mean, just courage and then wisdom. The wisdom to tie back Psalm 16 and this Psalm of David, this prophetic word, I mean, the wisdom to bridge that with the God-fearing Jews, and then just massive conversions. We read that 3,000 people in one day got baptized as a result of that message. So let me walk you through exactly what Peter does in this message. And I want you to notice how it started. You know, as Carrie was sharing, he didn't start with a joke, like me. He didn't start with like a, I'm just trying to bridge the gap here with everyone. He didn't start with a, hey, so these two guys died, and they went up to heaven, and they're at the pearly gates, and I'm there, and, you know, that was a joke, by the way, but nothing like that. He starts with, you, with the help of wicked men, put Jesus to death. You, with the help of wicked men, put Jesus to death. And then he ends it with, this Jesus whom you crucified. Wow. So that's the lead-in and that's the exit, is you, with the help of wicked men, put Jesus to death. And then this Jesus whom you crucified. And imagine what people in the audience were thinking when he said that. I'm saying, I didn't crucify him. I mean, I was over in Rome, or I was over in Phrygia, or I was over hanging out like hundreds of miles away. I didn't crucify him. I wasn't there. And even people that like shouted, you know, crucify him, crucify him, they would say, well, I didn't nail the nails in his hands and feet. I thought I was just kind of going along with the crowd. I didn't crucify Jesus. And so what Peter is going to try to do in this passage is he's going to try to show the people that they are guilty of crucifying Jesus because they're complicit in the act. In other words, they agreed with the verdict. And by agreeing with the verdict that Jesus needed to die, they in essence crucified him. Why did Jesus die? The charge against him was blasphemy. He claimed to be God. Why did Jesus get crucified? Because he claimed that God has endorsed me as the Messiah of all people. And the Jewish people said, oh, no, he didn't. And Peter said, oh, yes, he did. And let me explain to you why I believe and I know God endorsed Jesus. Here's Peter's arguments. Number one, check them out on the screen. God did signs and wonders through him. Fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs. Check this out. Which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. So the first thing he wants to say is that all those miracles Jesus did, remember when he came in and you were laying like branches down in front of him and Hosanna in the highest, remember all that? Remember when he healed the blind guy and he raised people from the dead? You remember all those signs? God did those through Jesus. So, obviously, God validated Jesus as his servant. But that's not it. Here's a second reason that God endorsed Jesus. He planned his death for the sins of the people. This man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge. And you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him on the cross. God planned that. Now, Pilate's plan to crucify him and God's plan to crucify him were very different. Pilate wanted to crucify him because he rejected Jesus as God, but God had him crucified because he acknowledged the fact and honored the fact that he was the Lord and Savior of the world. It was actually God's plan to have him crucified because, number three, God raised him from the dead. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. You voted no for Jesus, and God voted yes. You crucified Jesus, God raised him from the dead. You spoke out against Jesus, God spoke in favor of Jesus. God worked miracles through Jesus, in his foreknowledge put him to death, and then raised him from the dead. All the while, you've been standing against the very things of God. So it's not just that you killed a man. It's not just that you killed a holy man. It's not just that you killed a holy, innocent, moral man. You actually killed the man that God endorsed as Savior and Messiah of the world. And so you don't just stand against a man. You stand against God. Number four. And this is where it gets scary for the people, I think. Because they're listening to this, and Peter takes it up a notch, and he says, God exalted Jesus after he raised him from the dead and put all of his enemies under him. Check it out. God raises Jesus to life, and we are all witnesses of it. You know Jesus was raised to life. 500 people were witnesses of the fact that Jesus walked around after he died. 120 are standing in front of you right now. We're witnesses of this. We saw this. You can act like the disciples stole the body, and you can act like all these other things happened, but trust me, we're witnesses of this. We saw it. That's why I'm willing to put myself out there, because I know Jesus is the Messiah. He's raised Jesus to life. We're witnesses of it, exalted to the right hand of God. He's received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit and poured out what you now see and hear. And that exposes for the people the horror of realizing that we have not only killed a man or a holy man, we have killed the one, the Messiah, the Lord, that God Almighty has not only endorsed and raised from the dead, but exalted now into a position where he has judgment over us and can execute judgment on us for what we did. There was such conviction on the people that day. The Bible says their response was this. Peter says, therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. And their response is, what shall we do? We don't know what to do. We're going to die. I mean, that's essentially what it was. We're going to die. You ever been caught doing something you know you shouldn't? I mean, let's just for fun appease me here. Raise your hand if you've ever been caught doing something you know you shouldn't have done. Okay, everybody. Anybody never been caught? And you are just such a sneaky criminal, all right? A smooth criminal, right? To quote Michael Jackson. We've all been caught doing something. These guys are caught. They know that they are complicit, and Jesus is now the judge who is going to execute some judgment on them. A few weeks ago, my daughter, Grace, who's 2 years old, got caught. And I want to just share the story quickly, and you'll understand a little more in a minute. One of the members of our family got lost a couple weeks ago inside of our house. It's not because our house is so big, it's because our family now is so big. We have six people, we've got a dog, right? So kids just kind of wander, forage for food, you know, try to figure out how to live and survive. And so one of our family members got lost, and she has this propensity to disappear for long periods of time. She's kind of our hider. She likes to hide, you know, in the closet and bathrooms and secret places and stuff like that. And it was my wife, Katie. No. That also is true, I've noticed on occasion. But no, it was our little 2-year-old, Grace. And Grace was hidden, and we are yelling out, no, Gracie, where are you, Gracie? And she oftentimes will hide herself. It's super, super funny, actually. She backs herself into the bathroom and shuts the door, but her hand can't reach the light switch. And so she'll just be standing there in the dark, like in the bathroom behind the door, and all of a sudden we'll hear this, Mama, Mama. And we're like, where's that voice coming from? You know, oh, she's in the bathroom in the dark, the poor kid, but anyway, in this instance, Gracie, Gracie, where are you? Where are you? And finally we wander around and we go into Claire's room and we find Gracie, buck naked, with a tube of lipstick that she has proceeded to write all over her body and face. I have pictures. I decided not to show them because, you know, they're full shots. I mean, they're full nudity shots. And so, you know, you just, first of all, as a parent, you just kind of go, what is she, did she get shot? Like, what happened? You know, lipstick all over. Gracie, what are you doing? And here's what she did. I kid you not. Drops the lipstick and takes off running. I mean, just like, so you've got this little naked baby, you know, running down the hallway with lipstick. And I'm yelling up, what's going on? What's going on? And Katie's at the top of the steps. I come up, and there's Grace, head to toe, lipstick. Of course, it's all over her face. I mean, just all over her face. And she is just trying to get away. And finally, we catch her, and we stop her. And she repents, you know, with her little way of repenting. And we move on. And I think sometimes, you know, when you're caught, you have this tendency, I mean, it's from an early age, this tendency to run. We got to get out of here, you know. This is dangerous stuff. I remember in high school when, well, not that I did too many bad things, but a few times when the police started to come. I might need to get some water here. I might tell some stories for a while. But when the police started to come, it was like, hey, oh, the police are coming, let's go, let's get out of here, you know, and you run. The people realize, as Peter has dropped this incredible situation on them, saying that Jesus is now exalted, and he sees everything you do, and you can't run, and you can't hide. You crucified Jesus, the Messiah, and it's going to get really bad for you because of what you did. You rejected Jesus as the Son of God. And that's a funny illustration, but maybe the next one will carry a little bit more weight. And I won't give his real name, but we'll just call him Ryan. And Ryan was in our church in Des Moines, and his wife and daughter, 10-year-old daughter, had been attending our church for a while, and I'd always heard of Ryan but never met him. Well, finally, Ryan got out of prison. He was there for dealing methamphetamines and was kind of caught up in that, had a 3-year sentence, was convicted, so he was out early. He was on parole. I met Ryan at church one Sunday, and then the next and the next. He's trying to get his life together, but he knows the littlest infraction, and I'm right back in jail. And so I started to talk to Ryan, and as we got to know each other, he ended up giving his life to the Lord. Prayed with him. I remember baptizing him. Of course, mom and daughter are there, and they're crying. And, oh, praise God, you know, our husband, my dad, he's given his life to Christ, and drugs and all of that stuff are in the past. And I met with Ryan pretty regularly, and about 3 months after he got out of prison, he started to talk to me about a friend that wanted to reconnect, hang out with them. And so I said, man, I don't know. He's part of your past. I don't know if I would do that. No, man, it's cool. It's cool. I just want to talk to him about the church and da-da-da-da-da. And then a couple months later, I noticed he was hanging out with his friend a little bit more. And then a few months after that, as we met over lunch one time, I'll never forget it, Mexican restaurant, he's just kind of just jerking ever so slightly. And if you know anything about meth addiction, when you start to kind of tweak and do that, you're coming off of something, your body is, and he just denied it and tried to hide it. And I said, Ryan, man, are you using again? No, John, no, man, I'm clean, everything's fine, I'm good, I got my act together. Found out a few months after that, it's been about 8 months now, that Ryan had rented out his garage. One of his friends was using his garage to cook meth right outside of his house, put his family in danger. He was running to pharmacies, buying Sudafed, doing everything that needs to happen to make this drug. To make a long story short, a few months after that, Ryan got caught. He got caught by an undercover cop that was basically going through a drug transaction with one of his friends. His friends narked on Ryan. Ryan realize that I'm in deep trouble. Law enforcement called, said, you have 48 hours to turn yourself in. And he called me one night, about 11 o'clock at night, and he's crying. And he said, John, I don't know what to do. I'm caught. I got no alibi. I mean, I did it. I confess it. I'm so sorry. He's breaking down. He's crying. He goes, I got 48 hours. I don't know what to do. I can't run. They'll find me, and my prison sentence will be even more. I don't want to stay at home and wait for the police to come to my house and create a scene with my wife and my daughter, but I don't know how to tell them. I don't know what to do. He said, I know I'm facing probably a 10-year sentence as a repeat offender, and my daughter's 10 years old. The next time I get out of prison, she'll be out of the house. My wife's gone through this twice with me, and I don't know where she'll be. Let me tell you something, guys. Ryan was caught. And there was no grace. There was no way out. I had to drive to his house, pick him up, watch him in his living room say goodbye to his 10-year-old daughter, his wife, crying in tears, put him in my car, drive to the courthouse, turn him over to police officers, who cuffed him and put him in the back of a van and took him to jail for a long, long time. He's still in jail. When you can't run and you can't hide and judgment is coming, then you understand why the people in this story heard this, and the Bible says they were cut to the heart. And they said to Peter and the other apostles, brothers, what shall we do? What shall we do? And I want to say to some of you out there today, if you've offended God and you have not turned to Him and you have not repented of your sin, He sits in judgment over you. And there is a very real sense that in your heart you ought to be saying, Pastor John, I'm in that position right now. What should I do? Praise God for grace. Praise God for grace that when we feel cut to the heart, and I remember that time of just, man, late teens, pulling my car over and saying to God, Lord, I am sorry. What do I need to do? Peter says to them very clearly, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, and you will be on fire just like we are on fire right now. There's hope for you. There's hope. There's a way out. Oh, I wish I could have said to Ryan, Ryan, man, there's a way out. There's a way to put all of this behind you. But you know, the civil authorities don't have the kind of grace that God has for us. The Bible says that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us to be our sacrifice, rose again. Yes, He's here in this position of judgment, but He offers to every single person in this room, if you would repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, then you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit and you can be empowered to live a new life.
We just want to thank you for watching the sermon online. If God is working in your heart, we would love to hear about it. You can go online, www.encountertrinity.com/nextstepscard. You can fill out information there. Let us know what God is doing in your heart. If you need help with anything, we would love to help. Counseling, we would love to do anything that we can to help you go to that next level spiritually. When you fill this out, it goes to one of our pastors. It is private, and we will take care of that information to the best of our ability. We love you, we care about you, and we want to see God do great things in your life. Have a great day.